So let's just go through this article and take a quick look. It says U.S. Mormons still have more children than other Americans do, but their families are not as large as they used to be. First, let's look at fertility in previous generations. According to research from the 2016 Next Mormon Survey, NMS, today's Mormon adults grew up in families of 4.02 children. This was higher than the national average, and depending on the year, sometimes significantly so. For example, we have LDS and national data from the early 1980s that indicates that when Americans as a whole had a total fertility rate of 1.81 children, Mormons were having an extra kid and a half, a 3.31 fertility rate. Here's what that looks like. Now, for those of you who are watching the live stream, you'll see that there's a chart here. Total fertility rate, hypothetical lifetime, births per woman. So it looks like 1960, it hit its peak for, this is Mormon fertility, about 3.7 children per woman were born. And then 1981, it was 1.81 children. It hit its low at like 1977, I guess. And right now it looks like it's at about 2018, it's 1.73 children per woman. But I was just talking about this earlier. I knew this woman, this Mormon woman, I worked with her, really, really nice lady. And she was from a family of like 8 kids or something like that. There were a lot of children in that family. And I think she grew up to have like 6 kids of her own or something like that. Just anecdotally, I've known Mormons have a lot of children. They have a lot of children. Now, this isn't really a unique situation or an unexpected situation, because Mormons have historically, the leadership of the church has historically been very opposed to birth control. In fact, the article goes on to talk about it here. Let me just give this a read. It says, Mormons, it seems, held out past the time other Americans began to routinely use contraception. Much of this has to do with the unambiguous anti-contraception messages LDS leaders were sending to members even after the pill had been legalized. In the 1960s and 70s, LDS leaders still regularly spoke out against birth control. In 1969, for example, the first presidency counseled church members as follows. We seriously regret that there should exist a sentiment or feeling among any members of the church to curtail the birth of their children. We have been commanded to multiply and replenish the earth, that we may have joy and rejoicing in our posterity. For reference, posterity, I actually looked this word up earlier because I've heard it, but what did it mean? It means all future generations of people, FYI, if you were wondering. So they're saying, we have been commanded to multiply and replenish the earth, that we may have joy and rejoicing in future generations, basically. And then it goes on to say, where husband and wife enjoy health and vigor, are free from impurities that would be entailed upon their future generations. It is contrary to the teachings of the church artificially to curtail or prevent the birth of children. We believe that those who practice birth control will reap disappointment by and by. So this is from the 1969 presidency, I guess. That's who wrote all that stuff. It goes on to say, if this language sounds unusually formal for the 1960s, that's because the announcement was based on an earlier and considerably more incendiary statement from President Joseph F. Smith in 1917. Now, I just want to make note of something real quick. 1917 Joseph F. Smith is not the same as 1830s Joseph Smith. The founder Joseph Smith purported to find the gold plates in 1822, I think. Didn't dig them up till 1824. I could be wrong here, but I'm pretty sure that's right. And then really started to dig in with Mormonism from there. And it started to get really big over the next decades. And then he died in 1844. I just looked that up earlier. So now we have a Joseph F. Smith that's kind of running the church in 1917. And it says he made a considerably more incendiary statement. The article goes on to say 1917 was not coincidentally the same year that Margaret Sanger launched the Birth Control Review and served a month in prison for opening the nation's first birth control clinic. Contraception was very much in the news. I'm going to get to that in a second. We'll continue with the quote. It says, here's Joseph F.'s quote from a century ago, with the italicized parts being the fiery rhetoric that the first presidency quietly dropped in the 1969 version. I regret, I think it is a crying evil that there should exist a sentiment or a feeling among any members of the church to curtail the birth of their children. I think that's a crime wherever it occurs, where husband and wife are in possession of health and vigor and are free from impurities that would be entailed upon their posterity. I believe that where people undertake to curtail or prevent the birth of their children, that they're going to reap disappointment by and by. I have no hesitancy in saying that I believe that this is one of the greatest crimes of the world today, this evil practice. Now, I was just saying a minute ago, this isn't talking about abortion. This is talking about birth control. We have this political party in the US that is both opposed to abortion and they're opposed to contraception. Now, I understand there's a debate to be had about abortion. I get it. I understand why people would be upset by that. I understand why there's a debate. I personally think that abortion's going to happen whether we like it or not. In fact, there's evidence for that. Abortion is outlawed in some areas in the world. And guess what? It just goes underground. They do it in dangerous and unsafe ways. That's what happens. And criminalizing it more isn't going to stop it, period. It's just not going to stop it. So how do we stop abortion? If this political party in the US wants to stop it, how do they do it? What's the best way to prevent it? It's the one thing that they're doing the exact opposite of. They're stigmatizing and ostracizing birth control and contraception. Why? I don't understand. Why are they doing this? This is not helping. This is not helpful. This is doing more damage. In school districts that teach abstinence only, pregnancy and abortion rates are higher than they are in other districts. If they want to stop abortion, if they're really worried about it, if they're honestly and genuinely worried about it, then why are they trying to stop contraception at all costs? It doesn't make sense. We should be outfitting people with the tools that they need to prevent it from happening in the first place. Anyways, this article goes on to say, you can see the evolution here. Even though the 1969 statement is unequivocal in encouraging church members to avoid birth control, leaders have effectively decriminalized the practice compared to the church's earlier position. The 1969 statement was also followed by a list of certain allowances. Husbands should respect their wives' limitations and wishes about family size. Women's health should be a primary concern, etc. Okay, those seem like legit things. But let me just go back up here for a second. In 1917, Margaret Sanger launched the Birth Control Review and served a month in prison for opening the nation's first birth control clinic. That seriously, I don't understand where all of these ridiculous ideas and fears and beliefs come from about birth control. You don't want to have a child. Is that wrong? Is it wrong to not want to have a child right now? Or at all? What's so wrong about that? It just blows my mind. It says, gradually in the 1980s and 1990s, LDS leaders stopped overtly preaching against birth control, even though they still promoted the importance of children. In the 1998 handbook, contraception is considered to be a matter between the couple and the Lord, and church members are advised not to judge each other about it, as if. That don't ask, don't tell approach has effectively been the church's policy for the last 20 years. It's interesting that they have that position now, that whole don't ask, don't tell, it should be between the couple and the Lord situation, but it's still stigmatized heavily among people. The reason I say that is because Jehovah's Witnesses have this whole thing about blood transfusions, and I've talked about blood transfusions with Jehovah's Witnesses before, but they really refuse to take part in anything to do with blood transfusion. So medical advances have created medicines out of blood fractions, right? So there are different portions to our blood. There are different, there's, you know, hemoglobin, white blood cells and red blood cells and all kinds of different parts, platelets and things like that. And we've actually made medicine out of that. So how do Jehovah's Witnesses feel about that medicine? It's banned. They're not allowed to use it. Now, as time has gone on, they have lightened up a lot on that. And they've said using medicine that is made with blood fractions is not outright banned. It's a conscience matter. Just like they're saying here for Mormonism, contraception is considered to be a matter between the couple and the Lord. Jehovah's Witnesses say the same thing about certain medicines for blood transfusions. It's still heavily stigmatized. They still don't take it. If you don't outright say, yes, you can take this medicine now, or yes, you can have blood transfusions, which they would absolutely never say. Then it's stigmatized. It's part of the culture. Whether the church is saying you shouldn't or not, it's still part of the culture, and the leadership of the church is the only group that can change that. It's the only people who can change that stigma because everybody's following them and hanging on their every word. That's how churches work. So it continues on to say that don't ask, don't tell approach has effectively been the church's policy for the last 20 years. Its effect shows up clearly in the data. The NMS had three questions related to fertility patterns. The aforementioned question about the size of respondents' families growing up, another about how many children respondents have had themselves, and a third about what they consider to be the ideal family size, regardless of how many children they've actually had. Then it goes on to say, from the second question, we can see that Mormons are having fewer children than they used to. Gen X Latter-day Saints, who were ages 37 to 51 at the time of the 2016 survey and had therefore mostly completed their childbearing, showed a significant drop in family size. 57% of Mormon Gen Xers have had zero, one, or two children of their own. So it looks like things are moving in the right direction with it. We have a population problem and things, and honestly, if people want to have that many kids, that's their thing. That's okay with me. I'm totally 100% fine with people having that many kids. My real issue is with the fact that a church has been pushing people to have lots of kids up to this point, or at least slowly just backing off of the fiery, incendiary rhetoric about it. And it's kind of out of the people's hands at that point. In large part, it's a control method for people to push them to have as many kids as they can. It's also been very useful to reproduce and bring in new members of the church that way, since it's harder to bring them in from the outside.